working for a Nobel Committee for many, many years. And then you've been picking the Nobel Prize winners. What is the most important criterion?
The committee and the Academy of Sciences and the Nobel Foundation set rules, you know, how to choose. And the rules are, you know, that it should be, and this is in the will of Alfred Nobel, should be given for a discovery or an invention. That means that it is not a question about who is the best physicist in the world or who has done most, you know. It's given for a specific discovery or invention. And by doing that, it allows, you know, people can be lucky and get it. And there's nothing wrong with that. You don't need to be an Einstein to get it. What we have to do in the committee is to find the best candidates, to go through all nominations. It is a rather huge job every year, you know, and of course, all from the beginning, the committee did it very carefully. I mean, they would not give it to their friends or to the locals. They really, you know, tried to go out and look around the world. Because it was said in the will that it should be given irrespective of nationality. So you might say that it might even be more difficult for someone from Sweden or the Nordic countries to get it than from other countries in order, because the committee likes to be as fair as possible.
So you got a PhD, you've been working on high energy physics, quantum field theory, and then just developing string theory. So you've been one of the pioneers in development. What do you think is the most attractive aspect of string theory?
I still think that string theory is the eye-opener into the physics at the very small scales. It's not gone as fast as we thought, you know, 30 years ago. But think what we are learning is that we're digging into, you know, the very, very deep into to nature. And it has to take time. It's such a beautiful theory, I think. It's a beautiful idea, and it's internally consistent as far as we can see. And it connects very much to the modern theory of the standard model, which is, for the moment, progress is perhaps slow. We are not connecting to data as we should perhaps, but such things take time. This is sort of fundamental theory. We don't know the time scope of it, so you know, you should let talented people work on it. It will sort of both connect to the real world and, you know, going back to sort of the fundamental principle.
Korean students are studying hard, but they lack creativity. So there's such an impression. So what's your opinion?
I think it's wrong, you know. You have to have more confidence in yourself. You have Samsung, which is a world leading. I mean, of course, you have so many inventions in Samsung and all these other companies. So I think you have already shown, you know, that you can master these things. And I'm so happy to hear that you have this good school system. Because in Sweden, we have been experimenting so much with the school system. There should be all sorts of school democracy. And you know, there are also this that students should not study too hard because they, you know, they get burned out. And they, this is probably all is true, but you know, this is a competitive world. And if you want to compete on the world market, you know, you really have to be as good as the others. And here you have schools with good disciplines. In Sweden, we don't have any disciplines in school at all any longer. The students are highly motivated and they're very interested in science. And I'm sure that Korea will, you know, you will get your Nobel Prizes in due time, you know, both in several of the subjects that we have. Don't worry about lack of creativity. I'm sure you have shown it in other fields, that in other aspects, that you have so much of it, creativity in this country. Just building up this, this country from nothing, you know, 50 years ago, whenever it was. I mean, I'm so perplexed that coming here to see all these things, how you could do it. But of course, Korean people have worked hard.
From a previous interviewer asking you,
앞으로 이렇게 그 물질의 궁극을 쫓는 입자 물리학은 이렇게 미래는 어떻게 될 것인가?
Future particle physics. Yes, that's an interesting question. Particle physics had glorious times, you know, in 60s and 70s with the accelerators discovering new particles all the time, new theories, and eventually we could tie it up in what we call the standard model. And present and the LHC accelerator at CERN gives us so much data. So in 9 months of running time, they could prove in everything that all the accelerators before had been showing, you know. So in that sense, it's, you know, the world has benefited much from the particle experimentation, because much of modern technique, you know, has been sort of pushed forward by building the accelerators, like World Wide Web, you know. It, not only do you get new physics, you also get so much of the new technology coming out of that.